WYSL, Merry Christmas.
Mira la izquierda, mira la derecha. ¿Qué ves? ¿Dónde estás? In a world that seems to change daily, what will you do next? Welcome to the Next Steps Show with Peter Vazquez and co-host Ayesha Kreutz, a starting point for discussion y un poco de dirección. Bienvenidos, Sideshow on a mission with a vision. Soy yo, it's your host, Peter Vazquez, and our co-host...
Ayesha Kreutz.
It's a merry, merry, merry Christmas, everyone. I guess if you're listening on Saturday, merry Christmas Eve. Ayesha, you can plug your ears for this one if
okay.
You want.
Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, we truly hope you are warm, you are safe on this...
Blistery
day.
Like Winnie the Pooh.
Once in a lifetime storm.
Yeah,
I've heard that a couple times growing up, though. I figured these meteorologists are either not from around here, or they just think it sounds
good. I hear this every storm.
Every storm. It was the last two, well, like they canceled school out where I'm at, Orleans County, in the house, whoop whoop. And I was like, it hasn't even happened yet. Like, remember you have to wake, have to wake up in the morning and you sit in front of the TV and look to see if your school was going to be the one canceled or not. They canceled it yesterday.
I think they scheduled them out. Yeah, they did.
They canceled it yesterday at like,
some
places
canceled
12
Thursday
o'clock.
Night.
Yeah, Thursday. Wasn't today? Yeah, yesterday.
Oh, shoot. No, Wednesday night. I think a couple places closed for Thursday.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, ours was Thursday. And I'm like, what is happening? And they did that for the last storm, and the storm didn't actually happen.
No.
I'm not saying that it's not going to happen this time, and hopefully
well, we should always be prepared. I mean, you should always be on your game and have your shovels and salts and checking on your elderlies. And listen, make sure you bring your pets inside.
He said your elderlies.
Your elderlies. I like that.
Sorry.
But
going.
You know what? It's all about, first of all, what happens when you watch any TV station that has, you know, kind of a news department? Breaking news!
Right, right.
The graphic is always up because that makes everybody, it's eye candy. It makes you stop. Whoa, what's going on? So that's why every snowstorm now is Snowmageddon.
Are you telling me that there's entertainment in news?
Oh, yeah.
Are you telling me that they try to manipulate our emotions with the news?
No, oh, man, I can't imagine.
It's mind-blowing, isn't it?
That's not what the news is for. That's what we're here for, people. We're here to emotionally soothe you.
Absolutely. Don't forget to advertise in the Next Step Show.
Yeah.
We'll emotionally soothe your customers. Bob's just not talking.
I'm just trying to figure things out over here. Don't mind me.
But no, really. I mean, hopefully the storm, is not as bad as they say. But I will say, I'm just going to lay this one out. You had just said something earlier, Peter. You were like, and the winds are going to be 60 miles an hour. Guys, I'm from Key West in hurricane country.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, again, a big gust of wind with black ice, absolutely, I'm staying off the road. That's a whole different ball game, right? Or blizzard, blackout, snow, and a bunch of wind. But 60, 70 mile an hour winds is nothing.
I saw a meme. I think it was on Facebook, maybe. But it was in regards to the storm. It said, Southerners, absolutely, prepare, board your windows, do all that stuff. But Northerners, just put your heavy coat on.
Right, don't forget to zip it up.
Yeah, don't forget to zip.
No, you know what you'll see, though? I mean, during the storm, I just know this. If I stop and get some gas, go to a convenience store, there's going to be some guy at the gas pump next to me wearing T-shirt and shorts.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I see that all winter now.
Yeah, Rochester in the house.
Growing up, for those of us that have kids, I'm sure every parent's probably seen this. My kids, middle of a storm. In the middle of winter, they're fighting with me. I mean, shorts and shirts. Like, but in the summertime, they want to wear sweatpants and jeans and a hoodie. And I'm like,
what is going on here?
You know, something just dawned on me.
What?
You're like, I'm jealous.
Oh, okay.
Of you. And your whole anti-Christmas feel and stuff, because the rest of us feel this whole shut. Yeah, I never thought I'd use the word anti with you, but oh my gosh, you're like anti-Christmas.
I am not anti-Christmas.
I read your Facebook post. You're anti-Christmas. What was the last one? And I really can't stand all those nativity scenes. Yeah, you're anti-Christmas.
Finish that out. I cannot stand nativity scenes that have the wise men there. Because, again, it's just more of perpetrating lies, and people don't even realize it. The wise men were not there when Jesus was born.
It took them a while.
They came a week later, January 6th. That's why Puerto Rico celebrates Three Kings Day, that's our Christmas.
I know, but that's not true either. That was old, ancient church history, but that's not. Like, when you read in Scripture, it says that there was a child, he was a toddler, and he was in a house, right? It was probably a year or so afterwards that he was born, and that's why the Herod did 2 years, right? It was 2 years, any child who was 2 years older, younger, that he was going to kill. And so I'm like, listen, guys, we're just perpetrating frauds everywhere, and I think that truth matters.
Truth does matter.
So those nativity scenes, right? Like, and I've seen some people, they do the little nativity scene, and it's cute, and again, I'm not like anti-nativity scene, but right. Then they have the wise men are off in a distance coming. I can respect that. But if you have the wise men around your nativity scene all hanging out, I'm like, listen, that wasn't what happened.
So
bro.
you can have the baby Jesus in the manger that's my microphone you just turned off, but that's okay. That's your crop switch right there.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Anyway, so the baby Jesus in the manger on the church lawn is fine, but the wise men have got to be over on the used car lot across the street. Okay.
Yes. As long as that happens, it doesn't bother me, but those, I'm serious. I do get triggered by certain things. I mean, just December, Christmas in general. You are correct.
So
we celebrate in September.
Into Christmas parties, I assume, with a little pin, and anytime you see a Christmas balloon, You pop it.
Stop
you walk
it.
Around whispering into the little kid's
no,
ears.
Santa
doesn't exist.
I don't say anything usually, except for to my close friends or, you know, Facebook.
Or your radio audience.
Or you, now, my, well, you know, Peter brought it up. Even though, like, I listen, it's not a salvation issue, and that's something that Holy Spirit, like, once I was convicted of the issue about Christmas in December, and, you know, when we stopped doing all of that, you know, I was a little militant with everybody about, you know, what are you lying people doing all the time? And then Holy Spirit convicted me and said, like, who am I, right? Like, I mean, like, again, you don't need to be that pious or whatever, right? It's like, it's not a salvation issue. It's not like anybody's going to hell for it. Now, the difference is you're not getting your blessing. Because there's a blessing that comes along with celebrating and keeping the feasts that God commanded us to. Right? You don't have to. It's not like anybody, again, these aren't salvation issues, but they are blessing issues. And people wonder, why am I blessed so much? And they're like, man, and people say it all the time. Yes, the favor of God follows me. Again, the goodness of God follows all of his children all the time. But there is something in obedience. And when, again, September is the holiest holy month that Scripture sets aside for us to meet with God. And it just so happens that Jesus was born in that time period as well.
I was born in September, too.
Oh, high five. High five.
Yeah. September 18th. But, you know, I'll tell you.
That's it.
The blessings that you're talking about, you know, that immediate, I don't know if it's a punishment, God punishes, right? But for the rest of the world, the rest of us, right, that are out shopping for Christmas. Yes, we feel the pain and we feel the punishment
throughout the entire. But you know what, Ayesha, though,
I'll tell you.
But I love giving gifts to people. Anyway.
You know, but our kids are grown, so we haven't done this in a couple of years. They've all pretty much moved out, and I think some of them, as they're starting to celebrate their own Christmases, are doing something similar. But we used to take our kids out Christmas morning. We wanted to give meaning to what Christmas meant. So in the mornings, we would get up and see, this is what makes us not great politicians, and I guess you can call us statesmen, because we don't advertise this stuff.
Right.
But in the mornings, Christmas morning, my kids, they weren't able to open Christmas presents until after we went out and did something for someone else. So what we would do is on Christmas Eve, we'd spend it putting together anywhere between 50 to 100, sometimes 150 bagged lunches. And on Christmas morning, we would go out and go to what they used to call Tent City, and mm-hmm. we would. That's how I learned a couple of things. One is that Monroe County's homelessness problem is a political issue, not a. I know you and listeners. I understand there are people homeless, but I've also learned that a good portion of people mm-hmm. that are living on the streets, especially during the holidays, have chose to be there, and mm-hmm. all they're asking are two things. Let us be. We've got our own issues we're working through. We're not. There's no mental health issue here. We like it. A lot of them are veterans who are were trained, you know, they for whatever reason. So we learned that. And the other thing that we learned is that there are so many other services out there for people that are homeless. So definitely this Christmas, before you open up those presents, find a soup kitchen that you can go to mm-hmm. and volunteer. Take your kids there. Have them understand. You don't have to be spiritual or religious. You don't even have to call yourself a Christian, right? Just understand that when it boils down to doing for others, right? We talk about the feel of the season. It is. I mean, there's Christ in Christmas, in my opinion, for a reason. I know you don't agree, right? But let's keep that. Let's
Christ
make it about
day.
Doing the kind things for people.
Yes.
You know, if you're like Ayesha and you don't believe that...
But hold on real quick, though. And we would do the same thing, actually, that, you know, December, Christmas. Like, my kids grew up... We would go to the old folks' home, though, and the kids would sing songs.
Yeah, when I was young, I went to old folks'
and, home. We'd do crafts with them. That was always our, you know, because again, we didn't celebrate anyway, so we could spend the whole day there and give back. And I'm like, hey, again, I'll keep Christ in anything. Christ is first and foremost. So
Absolutely.
Again, take the day, and I would take it and say, okay, this is what we're going to do, especially because there's so many other people that are out there that don't have somebody, right? Or are somehow, you know, the holiday is not, as happy for them, you know? I mean, there's traumas and there's different things and deaths. And so we would always try and find someone to bless. We would do, you can't say the word anymore, but it's called knocking and knocking. You know, remember and knocking? No? Hmm. Okay. I can't say the N word, knocking.
Never heard of it.
Okay, so that's what we grew up with, right? It's like you'd go and you'd knock on the door and then run, right? And it was called N word knocking.
We called it ding dong ditch.
Okay.
We rang the doorbell.
Oh, okay. And so I never heard that before. But so that's what we would do on Christmas too. I would stalk a whole family and like maybe see somebody walking down the road with their kid or something. And like a week or so before, I'd stalk them, find out where they lived. And then we'd go buy some gifts. And on Christmas Day, along with going to the thing, we'd get a whole bunch of presents and we'd knock on the door or ring the doorbell, leave all the presents there, and then run.
And then run. Oh, that's
and get
sweet.
In the car.
That's cool though.
Yeah, so you know, it was just you know, it's not like the feel of the holiday isn't there. I just think it's an American holiday. So
so
gotta be clear, guys.
I want to back up a little bit.
All right.
This whole unknocking or the N word. I just gotta add, you're black. Am I right? I mean, are you?
I am. I am.
So as far as I heard, and please help me rationalize this. As I understand, that's an okay word to say if you're black. So why are you saying you can't say it?
So,
I don't think it's an...
I think that, okay, if you swear and you use other words like the F word or the B word and different things like that, I don't think there's any difference between saying that and the N word. That's just me personally. I don't like using any potty mouth words, so again, I'm not going to go around saying the F word anyway, right? But it's a potty mouth word. Okay? So if you think potty mouth words are okay, use it. And the reason, and whether you're black or white, whatever, and the reason that I say that is because until the day that rap artists do not use the N-word in their music and expect white people to make them rich, you can say it. Period. Yeah. Like, if you don't want people using it, don't use it in your music to get yourself some money.
Question over here. Is the N-word not an artifact or do black people call themselves each other that all the time?
No.
Is that part of the vernacular?
No. Again, there's that variation of, you know, like, and again, I don't know what you're allowed to say in the radio and stuff. You know, it'd be like, hey, N please, but it's not the whole word. It's just
Okay.
Duh.
At the end.
It's a and again, because then it's like, and there is a little bit of a history to that, you know, again, so I understand like where some, you know, people come from, you know, who are, you know, colored the way I am. But they started originally calling each other that as a way to take the sting out of it when it was used derogatory towards them. You know, you were talking like 50s, 60s type of thing.
It was kind of like a joking thing, right?
Well, it was more like, well, now it's like a joking thing in a way, right? Or it's like a brotherhood.
I mean.
Yeah, it's like a brotherhood thing, right? So again, in that aspect of it, sure. Yeah, I can see why. Be like, well, you don't even understand the sting of it. Right. But there is also history, right, that it's not necessarily a word for it's not a color word. Right. It means thief and low down and nothing. You know what I mean? Like,
well,
and,
Once upon a time, the dictionary defined the N-word as ignorant.
Right.
And there was another, but it had nothing
and
to do
thievery,
with race. But when you look it up now, the definition is specifically in regards to.
Right. And so,
black
and so I think that there's all these little nuances. So, I get why some people are offended by it and using it. But, again, that's the same thing, right? Back in the 80s, I had keychains that called myself the B word. And I'm seeing that cycled back now. Like, my kids would be like, oh, that's my B.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, why are we talking about ourselves like that? Like, girl.
It's the culture that's being created.
But, again, in the 80s, we did the same thing.
Yes,
literally had keychains that did it.
Yes.
So, again, the N word and how that applies to other people that are black are kind of in that vein.
Yep.
And so it's kind of like if you as a dude came over and called me the B word back in the 80s, I'd be like, you can't do that. But my girl could.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And that was OK because there was a camaraderie that was there. And so I think that's kind of how that works.
And to make sure that all married men understand that is never a word that applies to a spouse. Just saying. In any way, shape or form.
I can't imagine a situation where you would use that.
Not me. I married an angel.
I mean, either one of them, the N word or the B word.
Listen,
right?
Let my husband call me the N word. We'd be divorced.
That would be, you know, we could do that on pay-per-view. That would be interesting to watch.
My husband thinks he's black. Do you ever watch that sign?
So if he identifies as black, doesn't that make it okay?
It does make it okay.
I mean, just using
now
the logic from the other side.
Correct.
It's,
yes.
So listen, on this Christmas Eve, and if you're listening on Sunday on this Christmas, you know, one of the things that I ask our listeners to do is to just take a second and pause, maybe say a prayer, or just think about the 72 victims that have died up to this day in 2022 here in Rochester, New York. Please lift those families in prayers. But also, let's lift our city in general. Let's lift all our city leaders in prayer. I mean, we've got a core to a county that can flourish. However, it seems to be plagued with no jobs and no hope.
Mm-hmm.
Crime and a rise with leadership from the governor all the way down to the mayor, whose only resolution is more government control. I mean, it took a county legislator on the Democrat side to talk the mayor down from bringing the National Guard to control our cities. But yet they get mad when we call our city streets a war zone. Right? But in this Christmas, let's talk about changing the culture. We talk a lot about culture. I mean, that's what we do at Frederick Douglass Foundation. Yeah?
Yeah. It's all about the culture. It's all, you know, culture of Christ, culture of your family,
mm-hmm.
right? And bringing those positive things.
But culture of freedom?
Culture of freedom, right? Culture of the Constitution. And I think that, you know, you mentioned something in there, not only with the praying for those families. Again, 72 families. And you think about moms, dads, aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters, the people, best friends, everybody that is touched in 72 families in little bitty Rochester.
Yeah.
That is a lot of pain,
and
right? And this is their first, not that it matters whether it's your first or your 70th holiday without somebody that you love, you know, so I'm not taking away from that. But again, especially on that first and people getting through that, you know, your prayers are everything. You know, that is our only offensive weapon as a Christian. And so hopefully people do, you know, keep people in prayer. But on top of that, you had mentioned about how more government is always a solution, right? With some of these people. What they're selling. And I think that we as citizens, as voters, as societal members have to come back to the original idea of what America was meant to be, which is we the people, right?
Individual responsibility.
Individual responsibility, but that individual charity, right? I mean, like that's, and it's not about the selfishness of it, because again, there's a line I think that gets drawn sometimes where people don't understand the difference between the selfishness and individualism, right? That's what they try to do is say, oh, well, you're just trying to be selfish because it's all about you. And it's like, it's no. It's that I have a responsibility as a citizen to take care of me and mine.
In order so that to take you care don't, of the others.
Well, and so that you don't have to. Right? So that somebody else doesn't have to be the one that takes care of me. When my daughter got pregnant out of wedlock, and people were telling her that she should go get welfare, and I'm like, over my dead body, if something happens and that is a need and you have to, more power to you. I had food stamps. My kids grew up with food stamps, you know what I mean? Like in the early years as a single mom. But I didn't have family that took care of me. And I'm like, I will go broke to make sure that my kid doesn't need to put their kid in daycare or get government assistance or any of those things.
Because you broke the cycle. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the Next Step Show on WYSL on this wonderful Christmas blistery weekend. Ladies and gentlemen, hug your child, hug your pet, give a little. We'll
hug
be right
each
back.
Other. Yeah. All right, back with more on WYSL's Next Step Show.
Christmas bells.
Here's a special message for veterans and surviving spouses from Alpine Manor. You may qualify for a special benefit from the VA. After applying for funds received for aid and attendance, your stay at Alpine Manor could be as low as $600 per month. Be sure to call for details. At Alpine Manor, their pride is personalized care for seniors who are not yet ready for a nursing home. There are supervised activities and medications, full laundry and housekeeping services, 3 dietary-approved home-cooked meals, and a bedtime snack, all provided in immaculate surroundings. Be sure to call for details on this new program for the veteran in your family. Keep the golden years carefree years at Alpine Manor, nestled in the picturesque rolling hills east of 390 in Livingston County, just 20 minutes from Rochester. New York State Health Department license. Call 346-5880. That's 346-5880 for a no-obligation tour or information, or visit alpinemanor.com.
The all-new Victor Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram celebrates the holidays at their beautiful new location, 6484 Route 96. Save with grand opening values like the 22 Ram 1500 Bighorn Quad Cab 4x4 pickup in billet silver metallic clear coat. Dealer demo with 2,900 miles, only $289 a month for 39 months. Must have Stellantis lease loyalty. The 22 Jeep Compass Limited 4x4 is just $299 a month for 39 months. Must be Conquest or returning lessee. Or the 22 Jeep Grand Cherokee L is only $429 a month for 39 months in crystal black pearl coat. A 22 Ram 1500 Classic Warlock 4x4 Quad Cab Pickup in diamond black crystal pearl coat is just $319 a month for 39 months. $2,500 cash or trade. First payment DMV taxes and fees due at signing. Other conditions may apply. See dealer for details. We're here to fully serve Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, and Ram customers in Victor, Canandaigua, Macedon, Fairport, and Finger Lakes. Make it a point to visit the most beautiful new vehicle sales and service dealership in the area. Victor Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, now at 6484 Route 96, just east of Victor. Happy holidays.
The fair tax replaces the income tax and abolishes the IRS for good. But that's not going to happen if the current crop of politicians have their way. Fair Tax New York is looking for motivated citizens who are willing to contact candidates and get them to sign the Fair Tax Pledge, promising to push for fair tax if elected. Call Fair Tax New York at 585-944-0588. That's 585-944-0588. Make that call today.
Hi, this is attorney Christine Demo Vazquez. For more than 18 years, I've provided quality legal services tailored to the unique needs of each of my clients. I take the time to educate my clients about the law, explain the legal process, listen carefully, answer questions, and keep my clients informed throughout the process.
An attorney who understands the complexities of the family court system. Call attorney Christine Demo Vazquez at 585-427-0675. 585-427-0675.
Peter Vazquez and Ayesha Kreutz, The Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
Wow. Welcome back to the Next Step Show. Merry, Merry Christmas. Oh, wait a minute. We got a great Christmas song. Why am I singing?
Snowman was a jolly, happy soul. With a corn cob pipe and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal.
Hey,
Frosty the Snowman traumatized me when I was a kid.
Oh, it was kind of
because he melted, or
because it's got that sad component.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't you cry, I'll be back again someday. Yeah. I'll be like, oh, no, Frosty's gone.
Have you built snowmen growing up?
Oh, of course.
You know I've never built a snowman.
Well.
What?
This is the season to do it.
Well, there's no snow. We're just going to get wind and ice.
Just go over to Batavia. You'll find plenty.
Is there
snow? Yeah, it's supposed to snow there. Yeah, yeah. All my guys are on their toes this weekend because we're supposed to be seeing it. Already started snowing.
How do you live in New York and Rochester and have never
built a snowman?
He thinks he's still in Puerto Rico.
I never lived in Puerto Rico.
Oh.
No, you know what? It's just one of those things that in my crazy life, because, you know, I was a bit of a knucklehead, just things like that just didn't happen.
We're going to get you. We're going to go build a snowman with you.
I did a snow angel. I did snow angels. I thought those were the coolest. Anytime I was sad, I did a snow angel. But I never did a snowman. My brothers threw snowballs at me on a regular basis after hanging me up on a hook and tickling me.
Until you peed your pants.
What?
I won't admit that.
Yeah.
Hung you up on a hook.
What is it with siblings and wanting to tickle you and tell you?
Yeah, they used to hang me on a hook and just tickle because I was very ticklish and I was the annoying little brother that told him and everything. So I was always forewarned, though.
Well, Ayesha, you're sitting next to him, so
he doesn't smell like
feel free to test this.
I'm not
hypothesis.
Oh, that's weird. I'm not tickling Peter.
Tickle me. Oh dear. Anywho. Yeah.
But I'll get his brothers and sisters. I'll be like, can you guys do this? Because this is gonna be great. Can you show me what you used to do?
I've learned how to fight back in my older days.
Yeah.
You know, I can't the one thing that I can't stand about our holiday seasons is that it gets so politicized sometimes. I mean, we're talking Christmas already and Halloween, we got politicians using the holidays to do further division. You know, we've got our presidential moron with his Christmas message of unity that was the most divisive unity speech I ever heard. Take a listen.
I know, it's amazing, isn't it? Here it goes.
My hope this Christmas season is that we take a few moments of quiet reflection. Find that stillness in the heart of Christmas. It's at the heart of Christmas. And look, really look at each other. Not as Democrats or Republicans, not as members of Team Red or Team Blue, but as who we really are, fellow Americans, fellow human beings worthy of being treated with dignity and respect. I sincerely hope this holiday season will drain the poison that has infected our politics and set us against one another. I hope this Christmas season marks a fresh start for our nation. Because there's so much that unites us as Americans, so much more that unites us than divides us. We're truly blessed to live in this nation. And I truly hope we take the time to look out for one another, not at one, look for one another.
Whoops. Now, that was a little little happy ending to
wrong thing. So, but anyway, go ahead. It
infected our politics, right? I'll tell you, I do agree with it. I do agree when he says that this country is, and I'm going to paraphrase it, this country is way more than what we see. It's way more than this political nonsense, right? There is an opportunity to be able to come together, unfortunately, when we have leaders like him, leaders that are hypocrites.
Well, I mean, that's what I was going to say. That's what was like, I'm listening and I'm like, oh, it sounds so, you know, it sounds good, but it's pure hypocrisy.
Then he turns it into and uses terms like infected politics, obviously referring to a group of people that aren't like-minded like him.
Right. Maybe dividing once again.
I wish we would infect politics with our liberty-minded ways. Maybe we could fix some things. But the hypocrisy in him talking about coming together, not left or right or when that's all he does.
The speech was all he did. It in speech. It wasn't even like he tried going a little bit above to be
above
a little bit more.
Just that's true.
In his speech, it was a very divisive Unity speech. That's what it was.
A divisive. Well, you know.
Let's hear it again. Can we hear it again? Is that possible?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. How can we not see the divisiveness? If you don't,
ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, once again.
So my hope this Christmas season is that we take a few moments of quiet reflection. Find that stillness in the heart of Christmas. It's at the heart of Christmas. And look, really look at each other. Not as Democrats or Republicans. Not as members of Team Red or Team Blue. But as who we really are. Fellow Americans. Fellow human beings worthy of being treated with dignity and respect. I sincerely hope this holiday season will drain the poison that has infected our politics and set us against one another. I hope this Christmas season marks a fresh start for our nation, because there's so much that unites us as Americans, so much more that unites us than divides us. We're truly blessed to live in this nation, and I truly hope we take the time to look out for one another, not at one, for one another.
See, I mean, the whole speech itself is decisive. I mean, like, to think that most Americans are listening to his speech thinking that, oh, man, he's so warm and fuzzy. No, we hear you specifically saying those people who don't agree with you.
Well, and the thing, I think that most people at, you know, fundamentally anyway, that we are pretty united. I think it's the politics that is the divisiveness. Like, they're constantly trying to divide. But if you look at things on a personal level, right, like in my regular life, my friends that are Democrats, and, you know, again, when it gets to be election season, everybody gets crazy. But for the most part, I don't look at, you know, my friends that are, I don't know whether they're Democrat or gay or whatever. I'm not, you know, looking at, you know, like, that's
no,
not the thing
until
that,
until they tell me.
Right. Yeah, exactly. It was like, it's not like I'm, that's how we're looking at each other. I don't think that that's the normal state of people.
Listen, this guy is just outright disregarding American culture, which leads me to a question. And Bob, you're a history person. Roberto Savaje, Roberto Craig. How do you say
it? Craigay is what I was told.
Savaje. Oh, man, you know, every time I say that, I completely lose my train of thought.
You're Scottish-Hispanic.
Scottish-Hispanic. Anyways, American culture, right? I say this guy is just completely discrediting the American culture, but many people have said there is not an American culture.
No, this is, I mean, this is, it's remarkable when you look at this country and how diverse it is and has been for so, it's amazing that we all get along as well as we do.
But isn't that the culture?
That is American culture.
Yeah, I think that's kind of the hallmark of American culture is the melting pot.
Not the tossed salad. Unless you're with the LGBTQ, then you can go toss salad. But, oops, I'm sorry.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ayesha just has hauled off and belted Peter. Just thought you'd like to know. Too much violence on radio these days.
The mixing pot. That's what it's always been. That's our culture. We come together. It doesn't. Listen, I've never stopped being Puerto Rican.
Yeah, but the difference here is that when you have a melting pot, the original ingredients are gone. In terms of being the dominant trait is what I'm trying to say.
Right.
What we do is we come, I mean, e pluribus unum out of many,
that's right,
one.
Right.
That's
right. 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 Right.
Right. Right. And that was, you know, you just said you never stopped being Puerto Rican, but, you know, America is the only place that you can come and you become American. It's the only country in the world that is the case. When, right. Like, even like, you know, somebody came over from, you know, Scotland today or Libya or whatever, and they become a American citizen the legal way. You are now an American. You are not Libyan.
Correct.
Right? That is what that's the great experiment. Like, can we all come together? And that doesn't mean that we can't appreciate that original culture that we were in, right? Again, you have German American clubs, and I love the
Italian
Polish,
American,
you know,
of course.
Right? You know, which, again, why can't there be an African American club? So again, I'm completely okay with all of them, right? But I love culture.
You can't have an African-American club because it'll become racial.
Okay,
it'll become, you're not dark enough to come into this club. That's what it'll become.
Well, I mean, that's the case.
In this country, because, I mean, listen, we've got plenty of white Africans that's okay. that are being disregarded.
So for me, I'm okay with that.
That there's no white people coming to your club?
Correct. I'm okay if there's a white club with no black people in it.
Why?
I'm okay if there's a male club with no women coming in it, or a women's club with no men coming in it. I'm okay with all of
private
that.
Private clubs, absolutely.
I think that is their prerogative, right? It was like, hey, if you're Polish, I did try to join the Polish club because I love, and they're like, are you Polish? I'm like, I'm not. And so I could, but there's black Poles, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But I wasn't one.
Buddy of mine refers to himself. Stuff is a Puerto Rican.
A Puerto Rican,
he's
nice.
He's like heavy on the blue side and real in with the union, so I won't say his name. But
yeah,
that always stuck with me.
But again, it doesn't. Now, if all of a sudden I was an African American club and someone that again is from South Africa is white and they say you can't come here, then I might have a problem. Or if it's Italian and all of a sudden they're like, oh, it's only white Italians, and be like, okay, well, this is the white. You know what I mean? Like, then we start, maybe I might be irritated. But I still think it's okay. You want to know why? Liberty.
Liberty.
And I believe, right, like KKK, you guys are disgusting. And even though, founded by the Democrats. But if y'all want the KKK club, go ahead and go. Just leave me alone, right? Remember when they were coming out? I don't know where they were. Something recently, last 5 years or something. They were doing some march or something. And people were having, I'm not going to go counter protest, y'all. Mm-mm. You know what I mean? Because I don't think that is helpful, and I don't want to give you any credence, and I certainly wouldn't have the news out there being like, oh, hey, let's lift these people up and give them news. But if I was a news organization, I understand why they might. But that is your right and freedom of speech to do whatever it is that you want. Same with if you have a business. Goldwater, he was right about... one of the reasons you're getting elected was because of the 67, right? So the Civil Rights Act, right? It did go too far. It's one of the things, like, we should repeal that, because I do believe that as individual businesses, if you want to discriminate against me and tell me no shirt, no shoes, no service, if you want to tell me you wear glasses, you can't have service, if you want to tell me, Ayesha, you're black, you can't have service.
I don't know if I agree with that.
We have enough. Why? Especially now. You have people...
Well, because I do think that there's got to be a set of societal norms that are focused not on someone's... I don't think you should.
Wait.
If you're going to have a public business.
Aisha, hang on for a second.
But Peter, we don't go to that business.
We don't want government to be the arbiter of that, right?
I think that's what a free market is.
No,
correct.
That is true.
Right.
I see that.
Right. As the free market goes, that if I know that a business, right, is like, oh, hey, I don't want to serve women. First off, I don't want to give you my money and make you rich anyway. That's number one. You can still have protests. You can still have people come and say, hey, this business is discriminating against, again, whether it's LGBT, whether it's blacks, whether it's whoever it is. That's what the free market means, is that we're supposed to then say, I'm not going to frequent your business, and they go out of business.
You know what should be repealed and made illegal and should be completely barred from all public view?
I'm afraid the
presidential moron's creepy smile when he goes on TV and gives these divisive speeches,
which are all written for him, by the way.
So he should have a mask all the time.
He should wear a bag.
He has one.
Bag works. I can tell you it works. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the Next Step Show.
Peter Vazquez and
Ayesha Kreutz.
Oh, look at that.
And Roberto.
Salvaje.
We gotta roll the R's. You gotta roll the R's?
Roberto, of course I can.
We'll be right back.
Fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. As long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
Need help with health insurance? The Greece Regional Chamber provides assistance with health insurance for businesses, nonprofits, families, and individuals throughout our region. We pride ourselves on the personalized service that we provide for our clients. Let us help you find health insurance plans that fit your needs and navigate the paperwork. Greece Chamber Benefit Partners, located at 2402 Westridge Road in Rochester, New York, offers a broad range of medical insurance plans for businesses, nonprofits, individuals, and families throughout the greater Rochester Finger Lakes region, working with insurance companies including Excellus Dallas Blue Cross Blue Shield, Univera, and MVP Healthcare. We can also help you access insurance plans through the New York State of Health, the official health plan marketplace. Again, you do not need to live or work in Greece to utilize our brokerage services. We serve the greater Rochester Finger Lakes region of New York State. Visit GreeceChamber.org to sign up for one of our free health insurance information sessions or schedule an appointment with one of our licensed brokers. Call 585-227-7272. 585-227-7272.
Best wishes for a Merry Christmas and a joyful and safe winter driving season from Victor Chevrolet. Now, lease a 2022 Chevy Trailblazer LT all-wheel drive for just $319 a month for 39 months.
$2,500 cash or trade required.
Get the cold weather safety and capability of a 2022 Chevy Silverado Custom LTD Crew Cab for just $399 a month for 39 months.
$2,500 cash or trade at closing.
And then there's a 22 Chevy Equinox all-wheel drive LS for just $289 a month for 39 months.
$2,500 cash or trade equity at closing.
And don't forget, Victor Chevrolet has an unbeatable pre-owned selection. Whether you drive a Chevy or not, trust your vehicle to our Chevy Certified Service Department. Come see how easy it is to do business with us. Find new roads at Victor Chevrolet, Route 96 in Victor.
Visit VictorChevrolet.com.
These lease deals include returning lessee rebate. All factory rebates, incentives, and discounts are applied. Security deposit is waived. 10,000 mile allowance per year, 25 cents each additional mile. Must have lease and household. Tier 1 credit approval required. Lessee responsible for repair and maintenance. Conditions apply. Get details at dealer.
Geneseo Hardware and Rental has all your project needs. They have a large selection of hardware, plumbing, electrical, home goods, lawn and garden, plus much more. Geneseo Hardware offers Valspar paint, Cabot stains, a wide selection of rental items, plus screen and window repair. Get personalized service. Open 7 days a week. Geneseo Hardware and Rental, Route 20A next to Wegmans Plaza. Visit geneseo-rental.com.
Now offering lumber.
Hi, this is attorney Christine Demo Vazquez. For more than 18 years, I've provided quality legal services tailored to the unique needs of each of my clients. I take the time to educate my clients about the law, explain the legal process, listen carefully, answer questions, and keep my clients informed throughout the process.
An attorney who understands the complexities of the family court system. Call attorney Christine Demo Vazquez at 585-427-0675. 585-427-0675.
The fair tax replaces the income tax and abolishes the IRS for good. But that's not going to happen if the current crop of politicians have their way. Fair Tax New York is looking for motivated citizens who are willing to contact candidates and get them to sign the Fair Tax Pledge, promising to push for fair tax if elected. Call Fair Tax New York at 585-944-0588. That's 585-944-0588. Make that call today.
Peter Vazquez and Ayesha Kreutz, the Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
Just check this out for a minute or two. Love her voice. Love this version.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled.
That is a new song. I don't think I've heard that version.
Oh yeah. Aaron O'Donnell.
Yeah, I'm going to have to get that on my, Aaron O'Donnell.
Oh, dear. That's what she sounds like. Sorry.
A quick message from one of our sponsors.
Oh, sure.
Fairtax.org and conventionofstates.com wish all our YSL listeners a Merry Christmas and an all can think and teach, or as we like to say, an act. New Year's. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Next Step Show.
I love, yeah. And, you know, if people haven't checked out that Fair Tax or Convention of States, they really should. I'm actually a fan of both. Income tax should be completely eliminated.
Absolutely.
That is slavery, right? A man is supposed to get his wages, period. The government has no right to your income. That's it. Like, you can put on, if people want to check a box and say, hey, I want to, you know, again, I want to make sure you have your bridges or whatever it is that the left always says that we're not going to have. Because, you know, before income taxes, we had no roads or bridges. or fire departments or police.
Yeah.
You know, it was only because we have income taxes that those things exist.
It's amazing. You had to walk all until 1913 in this country. You had to walk all the way around that river.
Yeah.
To find the end of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or swim.
Swim across, right? Like there was no bridge across, and we couldn't figure anything out. You know, your horses. You'd get on your horse and, you know.
Walk across the water.
Yeah, you know.
You know, the city school district finally hired a new superintendent.
Yeah, number 17 in the last 10 years.
So that in itself isn't like exciting news, right? Just so that our listeners know, it's Carmine, was it Pelusa?
He's the
acting, or he was the interim superintendent. Although I never understood, if you're going to make somebody interim, you might as well just hire him. I mean, if they're good enough to run it.
They're test driving him. Pretty much, I guess. Taking him around the block a couple times.
Yeah, maybe.
But this is what got me from this whole decision. This is why I'm bringing it up on the show. The board chair, right, said, her name is Cynthia Elliott. She's the board president of the Rochester City School District. She said, I know the community was expected to be involved in the superintendent search, and that was our desire for them. However, the work of Dr. Pelusa has accomplished throughout his career, and these few short months cannot be overlooked. Super duper great. But you see, when we talk about big government, when we talk about government that says they know better than you, they say statements like that, and that's the kind of statements I want our listeners to pay attention to. When you hear a politician say, it was our desire for them to do that, however, we chose to do something different. No, that's unacceptable. Even if the decision is just to hire someone, especially when it's being done on taxpayer dollars. And Ayesha, talking about taxpayer dollars, 29% increase in a pay raise for the entire state house that's been approved. Merry Christmas, all state legislators. You know what gets me? You guys, Bob, you run a business. Ayesha, you run a business.
Yes.
If we took the state's scorecard as to effectiveness and performance, they would all be terminated.
Yeah.
That department would probably even just be eliminated completely because it's lost. But they're talking. Do you know that they're going to be the highest paid state legislature, second to California, who's got a bigger population? But they said that they limited outside income to what? $35,000, $32,000, something like that. So what we've
That's
created
crazy.
Now was what?
A political class.
Yeah, and a class of rulers.
Right.
Is that what we have now?
Yeah. Well, it's been that way for a while, Peter.
Well, it has been, but now it's been codified, kind of like abortion.
They are. I mean, and that's what they're doing. I guess I should know and believe that it passed, but I really, you know, like even when they were talking about, like when you came in today and said, I was like, it passed?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. There is a part of me that just, I can't believe that this is continuing to happen because we are, and people have to really pay attention that we are creating a political class.
Yes.
Right? That is going to be
a ruling class. Let's be clear, because this isn't just them wanting to be elected officials. Because they also changed the rules, right, to now, election rules, to now where taxpayer dollars are going to be funding elections.
Yes.
So
yes.
These incumbents are going to have yet more. Hey, I want to play a clip, Bob, if you don't mind, for listeners, that's going to kind of talk about the rationale from those that supported this. So that everybody knows, all Republicans voted against it, I understand. And I think a couple of Democrats may have as well. But if you don't mind.
This is a full-time job, I think people understand, and we work hard, and it's time to finally resolve the issue of COVID.
We did factor in an inflation rate. We're also, frankly, assuming that we will go many, many years again before we increase the salary based on the statistics of how infrequently we raise our salaries.
Show me the money. That's what it's all about. We deserve more money.
We never, ever want to mix compensation with policy.
Now,
first off, can I just say, I know you were going to go. I'm sorry, Peter.
No, go ahead.
It's not a full-time job. It's never meant to be a full-time job.
Nope.
It should not be a full-time job.
6 months.
Period. Period, period, period. You are supposed to be servants, and the idea and the audacity of these people to say something like that, you guys should all be offended. Go
Absolutely.
Ahead.
Now, to be clear, that third voice, the voice of the guy, that's Eric Adams, who then was the senator in the 20th district of New York State, and now the mayor of the city of New York.
God help us.
Give me the money. And to be clear,
you got to hear that whole clip too from Eric Adams. I mean, yep. he goes on and on about it's just like unleashed greed.
It is. That was a 2018 clip though. The other ones were in regards to this current. That first voice was a Stuart cousin. She's out there. I went blank with her name. The
House Speaker.
The House Speaker. Yes, in
Assembly
the state
Speaker.
And then the other one was Senator Liz Krueger. These are individuals that are sitting there literally telling us that they want to rule and they want us to pay for it. Now, let's put these numbers a little bit into perspective, right? We're talking $110,000 is what they're currently getting paid. And this is base pay. That's going up to $142,000.
Yeah. And they wait until right before Christmas to do it.
To rape us some more. That's what they're doing, raping the taxpayers. And if you want to raise, first off, it should be going to a vote, right, to the people. It should be like, why can't I think of the word? Oh, my gosh.
Referendum.
A referendum on the, right, like when we go and vote. You should not be able to vote yourself a raise.
What do you think about Stuart Cousins' statement there, the last clip? Where she talked about how they never, ever want to talk about or mix, you know, their pay with any policy discussions. However,
a joke.
This is the second special session that the taxpayers had to pay for to give themselves a raise that we got to pay for.
How could it not be politics?
Oh, my gosh.
Seriously.
How are you guys falling? I mean, again, these people should never be voted for again. I don't care. Republican, Democrats, come on. Like, just, they're... Comes a time when you have to say enough is enough.
Listen, we've got people hungry. We've got people that businesses that are struggling as a result of the policies of these individuals. And I'm not even talking COVID policies. I'm talking just straight up regulations.
Yeah.
Should we do some free soup? What do you think?
I think we should do some free soup.
Now, free soup with Ayesha Kreutz.
18 Republican senators, 18 voted for $1.7 trillion fleecing of America. Over $100,000 was spent to study a replica of Thanos from the Avengers to make sure he would be able to snap his fingers even though they are made of metal. 18 Republicans voted for this crap. One Democrat said it won't be inflationary because most of the big ticket money will be sent overseas. Russia spends $70 billion a year on their military. We have given Ukraine $110 billion. What is the point of having a Republican Party that has no ability to see the difference between themselves and the party that they are elected to oppose? What's the point of voting Republican when most of the Republicans refuse to vote different than the Democrats? What is the future of the country when those elected to save America repeatedly just stab her in the back? If those in the government won't abide by the will of the people, it's time for the people, for Americans to step up and take over. Long live America.
Rise up, stand up. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the Next Step Show on the WYSL stations with Ayesha and Peter and Roberto. It's a great Christmas, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, it's a year of giving. If you get phenomenal, but don't forget to give.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, all. Thanks for listening. And we'll see you one more time before the new year. Or will we? No, it'll be, it'll be New Year's Eve.
New
Year's Eve. All right. Merry Christmas, all.
Merry Christmas. Keep me warm.
I cannot remember a worse December. Just watch those icicles fall. What do I care if icicles fall? I've got my love to keep me warm. Oh, with my overcoat, off with my glove. Who needs an overcoat? I'm burning with love. My heart's on fire, and the flame grows higher. So I will weather the storm. Why do I care how much it may storm? I've got my love to keep me warm. I thought you ought to know my heart's on fire. The flames, they just leap higher. So I will weather the storm. Why do I care how much it storms? I've got my love to keep me warm. I've got my love to keep me warm.